The Autobiography of Harold Lloyd. The life story of a plain, freckled, ornery American kid, as he calls himself, who has won immense wealth and worldwide fame, is one of the absorbing romances of the motion picture. Photoplay, May 1924. It is impossible to cast any glamour over my youth. It was exciting enough, and filled with incidents and what, to me, was adventure, but there was nothing romantic about it. I spent most of my time looking for trouble, and I usually found it. I was just plain, freckled, ornery American kid. We moved so frequently in those days that my background is pretty well scrambled, and it's like making a picture puzzle to fit together the things that happened and the places where they happened. When the family discusses it, all disagree. Anyway, most of the towns in Nebraska and Colorado were pretty much alike, and the scenes of my life were laid somewhere in those two states until I was 18. I made my entrance into this world in the little town of Burchard, Nebraska, on the 20th of April, 1893. My folks were just folks. We weren't any different from other folks in Nebraska, except I think we moved oftener. I think we moved oftener than any other family in the state. We lived in little towns, in small frame houses, and our existence followed the ordinary course of families of our class in that location. It was a hard country, and we were never very prosperous, but we were never really poor. My father had what is sometimes called an itching foot. He was always wanting to go somewhere, and every time he changed towns, he changed business. At various stages, he owned a shoe store, a photograph gallery, a hardware store, a sewing machine agency, and a restaurant. He liked to go to new towns and start a new business, but I think his real ambition was to see as much of the country as possible. Generally, he was described as one of our successful merchants. My mother's name was Elizabeth Fraser, and she came from Toulon, a little town 70 miles south of Chicago. You know what every fellow thinks of his mother. I don't remember that I thought much about her when I was a kid. I was pretty busy, but she was an omnipresent fact, like the air I breathed. No boy ever had a better mother and father, and I surely led them an awful life when I was young. I wasn't vicious, but I sure was ornery. I had one brother, Gaylord, 5 years older than I, and he was my idol. He says I was a terrible nuisance as a baby. Sometimes he had to wheel me around in my perambulator, which interfered greatly with his own schemes. Besides, he considered me anything but beautiful, and thought that, for the honor of the family, I should be kept as much undercover as possible. Once he parked me at the railing in front of the general store and left me, and my career all but ended there under the dancing hooves of a farmer's bay mare. We left Burchard when I was 6 months old, so my recollections aren't very authentic about it. We went first, I believe, to Humboldt, another small town, and still later to Pawnee City. Then we went to Denver for a little while. From there to Beatrice, stopping somewhere on the way, and once spending a short time in Fort Collins, Colorado. From Beatrice, we went to Omaha. Nebraska is a cold state, and 20 or 25 years ago, life there wasn't any too easy, especially in the small towns and on the farms. My early recollections are of great space, immensity, ruggedness, barrenness. There was a thrill about it all, though, and it seems to me we had more fun than kids do nowadays. And we worked harder, and it was good for us. The winters were hard, but wonderful. There was snow everywhere, miles of it, great mountains of it, shutting in the little frame houses, with drifts up above the windows and folds down over the eaves. As far as you could see for months at a time, there was nothing but ice and snow. But it was a great time for sport for the kids. When I was 5, I got both my feet frozen and was nearly ruined for life. Only 5 or 10 minutes stood between me and not having any feet. My brother Gaylord belonged to a gang of older boys, and the ambition of my life was to follow them in their hazardous career. They were going up the river skating, on a bitterly cold afternoon, and I wanted to go. You know how kid brothers are, always tagging along. I was the town's prize tagger about then. I howled and yowled and clung to mother's skirts, pleading to go, and finally she said I might. She told Gaylord to build a fire for me on the bank, so I could keep warm and to watch me carefully. Gee, I was popular with those big kids, and especially with Gaylord. But I trudged along, blissfully happy. The boys built a fire and I settled down, warm and comfortable. But after a while, the fire went out. It grew colder and colder. I tried to build it up and couldn't. I cried and cried, but the boys had disappeared around the bend and couldn't hear me. I can still remember my terror as dark came on. When the boys came back, I was nearly frozen. I remember I couldn't feel my feet as I walked home, nor anything under them. The sensation intrigued me, but I was pretty cold and scared. When we got home, my mother nearly collapsed. My feet were frozen black. She didn't know which to do first, take care of me or deal with Gaylord. Finally, she and father split the difference, and mother began applying snow and other remedies to my poor little feet, while dad took Gaylord into the proverbial woodshed. After much agonizing prickling, during which I howled valiantly, my feet were saved. In fact, I think I could walk before Gaylord could sit down. But he evened things up, because the next summer, he saved me from drowning. I was always crazy about swimming, and I wanted to do like the big boys, so I jumped off the bank into the deep part of the swimming pool. I'd come up the second time and was on my way to eternity with the third down, when he grabbed me by the hair and towed me to the bank. I was always a marked man in any town where we lived because of my freckles. Naturally, I was proud of them, though as I look back, they were probably the most terrifying freckles I have ever known. Wesley Berry might have served as a cold ice cream ad for a perfect skin beside me. I was not only freckled in an amazing, unbelievable profusion, but my freckles were the reddest, most glaring ones that ever were. I was always described as the Lloyd boy with the freckles. As I grew older, I was usually engaged in a death struggle for supremacy in my gang. There aren't many things in my childhood to which I personally can point with much pride, so perhaps I may be allowed to state that I was pretty often leader of my gang. I could think up more things to do than anybody else. I used to get licked in fights a good deal, and I couldn't have maintained my generalship by force, but I usually won my place back by thinking up some new game which I alone knew how to engineer. I remember the fellows used to refer to me as a slicker. But my life wasn't all sunshine. I had an aunt who lived near us, and while she was and is a dear, kind, estimable Christian woman, there is no denying that she was the bane of my boyhood. Gaylord tended to do the chores for my mother, and I was lent out to my aunt. I had to show up there right after school and every Saturday morning to see if she needed any assistance. She always did. She was a genius at it. She always had a clothes wringer to turn, or a lawn to mow, or walks to sweep, or a back fence to whitewash, or paths to shovel, or wood to chop and carry, or trips to the store to be made, or chickens to be fed. The sight of a clothes wringer can still make me wince, but I figured pretty well. Even then, I was crazy about magic and sleight of hand and tricks of all kinds. I ran errands for the neighbors who would give me pennies and did chores to save up my money to buy any tricks I saw advertised. I used to sell seeds and bluing and cut glass dishes to the town if the premium was a magic trick. I imagine, looking back, that I must have been fairly good and accomplished what were then some slick tricks because I got quite a reputation for it in every town where we lived. Even the grown folks would watch me. But the kids were always especially awed and interested by my stuff. They wanted to know how it was done. One trick specially, which I called my illusion, had them all guessing. I wouldn't tell them how it was done, and it was the great mystery. But finally, my aunt wanted her backyard cleaned and the stable whitewashed. It just seemed to me I couldn't get through it, so I told the boys if they'd help me clean up that backyard, I'd show them how I did the illusion. And though it nearly broke my heart, I did. In school, I was just plain ornery. I wasn't exactly dumb, though I never could write compositions or anything like that. But I was always too busy thinking about things that interested me to pay any attention to the teacher. I expect most of my teachers thought I was born to be hanged, but they just didn't understand how busy I was thinking. When I was in the fourth grade, I stirred up a town fight. I'd done some special piece of mischief, and the teacher made me stand up in front of the whole class. Then she told me to hold out my hand. She took up a ruler that looked as big as a flagpole. I saw her raise it over her head and swing it down, and I couldn't stand it. I pulled my hand away, and she banged herself on the knee, and oh, but she was mad. Naturally, the kids all hollered laughing, and so did I, for about 1 minute. She went out and came back with the principal. He looked around the room, over his glasses, and my stomach turned right over. Then he said, pointing one finger at me, "I want to see you, young man." I followed him into the coat room with my knees shaking, and when I saw he had a big black snake hung on the wall, I nearly fainted. He gave me an awful beating, because he said I was too ornery to live. His black snake tore the shirt right off my little back, and it laid welts around my shoulders as big as your thumb. When he was through, I left him flat. I was sick and discouraged, and overwhelmed with a sense of injustice, and I felt he'd done his worst. I ran out of that building, him after me yelling for me to come back, down the street, and home to my mother. Mother took one look at me, and she went on the warpath. I trailed behind, while she sailed right down to that principal without even stopping to take off her apron. She was a little, slight woman, Mother was, and he was an awful big man, but she ended up by making him apologize to me right there in his own office. She told him there wasn't any man alive could manhandle a child of hers that way, and I guess she was right. Anyway, she and some of the other women got together and forced them to stop using black snakes or straps to whip the children. In view of my general surroundings and upbringing, my yearning for the stage and my desire to act seem a strange phenomena. I had no background for the stage. There had never been anyone in our family connected in any way with the theater. Nebraska in those days was a splendid young country, but like all young countries, it was fully occupied with the business of getting a living and of progressing commercially. In many ways, I imagine, it was crude and rough. Certainly, it wasn't strong on culture or the arts. There was no leisure class that I remember, and very little time even for amusement. Education itself was limited to the old reliable public school curriculum. The ambition to be an actor or an actress was almost unknown. Most of the boys had more sane and commendable desires, such as to go into the coal and feed business, or to work in the hardware store or the livery stable. I was possessed from my earliest youth with a definite, violent desire to act that in no wise conformed with the rest of my character. My mother claims that it was a mark of prenatal influence. Some people believe in those things, and others don't. I don't know myself. However, the fact was that Mother had always wanted to be an actress. In her hometown, back in Illinois, before her marriage, she had been the most successful amateur actress, and had played the leads in school plays and social and benefit performances. She longed with an intense longing to go on the stage. Her family wouldn't hear of it. They were shocked at the mere suggestion. There was some hard feeling, some determination on her part to run away and carry out her ambition in spite of the opposition. But just then, my father came to Toulon from some other town in Illinois. She fell in love with him, and that settled the stage. But the feeling persisted. After they moved out west, she was still interested in the stage and kept in touch with everything theatrical she could. She read all the plays she could get her hands on, and even took a New York paper for a while for the reviews it gave. She would drive for miles through a snowstorm to see a ham troupe in some barn opera house, and she read Shakespeare for amusement, somewhat to the amazement of her friends in the small towns where we lived. When I was a little fellow, 3 or 4 years old, I'd come in tired from playing, and Mother would often take me in her lap, and I would go to sleep to the cadence of Portia's speeches or Juliet's lovemaking. Anyway, as I grew, I loved shows. There wasn't any game on earth to me like a show. And I was a pretty darn good showman, if I shouldn't say it. But even better than the shows we got up, I liked my own private performances. I used to collect masks that were left over from Halloween, and I'd gather up the old hats and caps and put them all around on chairs for my audience, and then I'd act. I was a regular scenery-chewing tragedian in those days. Once, at Christmas, I got a box of soldiers. I was crazy about them, but I never played war. I used to rig up a stage with a real little curtain and use my soldiers for actors, speaking the lines myself. And I used to get little pink and blue and lavender pill boxes from the drugstore, the small square kind, and open them up and stand them around for the women members of my company. But I would have died of shame if anybody had found me out. My first appearance on the stage was in Denver, when I played Banquo's son in Macbeth. My appearance was brief and to the point. I was to accompany my father onto the stage, and when the murderers leaped from behind the trees and fell upon him, I was to dash on across the stage and into the wings, crying, "Help! Help!" I was to cry 2 helps on the stage, and 2 more faintly when I got into the wings. Mother was delighted with the opportunity for me to appear on a real stage, and I liked it pretty well myself, although I pretended I didn't. Mother fixed up the costume they had, a velvet suit and cape and a little plumed hat. I felt rather silly in it, but secretly I imagined I was a thing of beauty. I think I was about 7 at the time. I didn't cover myself with glory, however. I got out the first 2 helps in great shape, but that exhausted me, and one of the stagehands had to do the offstage work in a high falsetto voice. Right after that, we moved to Beatrice, Nebraska, where my father had been given the agency for a sewing machine. Times were pretty bad, and he got only the commission from his sales. And just then, men weren't buying their wives sewing machines. So I decided I'd try to help. I've always had a practical turn of mind, and wanted to make things pay and do well. I suppose if I hadn't had the queer streak of acting fever, I'd have been a businessman of some sort. Anyway, I started a popcorn business in Beatrice. Mother made the popcorn, and I sold it, and we did remarkably well. I had the greatest possible fun out of it, too, and I thought I was grown up. But I really do like to remember that I helped out quite a lot, though I was only 9. Mother was very proud of me, too, and I could see I had made her happy. I learned enough from my popcorn business, and I believe I also played child parts with several traveling shows that came through there, so that when we got back to Denver, I had enough money to buy a paper route from the Denver Post. I delivered papers myself, and I had several boys working under me. Nights, I worked as a candy vendor in a theater, and did odd jobs for the management, or the company, or anybody that would let me. I liked the money it enabled me to bring home, but most of all, I loved getting my freckled nose inside the door of a theater, if it was only the front door. I got a chance to appear a few times, once playing a newsboy in a show James J. Corbett brought to town. When I was 11, we moved to Omaha, and there happened, by a strange coincidence that I always like to remember, the thing that decided my fate, and that at last opened the stage door of the theater for me. Astronomy was my hobby. I was a nut about it. Like every hobby I've ever had, I lost all reason and was interested in nothing else beneath the sun. I drove everyone who came near me crazy with questions and pestered the librarian for books on astronomy, though at the same time I was neglecting my regular schoolwork. Down on the main street of Omaha was a man with a giant telescope and a stand bearing a big chart of the heavens. He gave lectures on the stars, and then tried to sell you an almanac or a view of some one of the planets through his telescope. My life centered around that street corner. I used to bolt my supper, grab my cap in a sort of daze, and dash down there every night of my life. His spiel entranced me. One evening, just as he was getting to some dazzling explanation about Saturn, a fire engine came down the street, clanging and tooting. The crowd left the astronomer flat and ran to the fire. All but young Harold Lloyd. A fire meant nothing in my life. What was a fire more or less compared to Saturn's rings? But the Spieler wasn't going to waste his eloquence on me. He stopped, and I stood there, gazing at his brilliant chart with my mouth open and my eyes popping out of my head, as usual. Suddenly, I became aware of someone beside me, and looked up into the amused eyes of a very smartly attired young man, who seemed to me the handsomest person I had ever seen. He began to talk to me, smiling a little, and told me he had seen me there every night for weeks as he went by on his way to the theater. Theater. That was the magic word to me. I was struck speechless with awe, but I stared my admiration. And when I found he was an actor, the juvenile of the Burwood Stock Company of Omaha, which to me represented the seventh heaven, I was ready to fall at his feet. His name was John Lane O'Connor, and, though I did not know it then, he was one of the best-known stock actors in the West. He had played with Otis Skinner and several noted stars, and was an experienced performer. This man was to be the great factor in my life, the one person who actually molded my destiny and my character, and to him I owe the deepest debt of gratitude. Finally, I found my tongue, and we stood there talking. He asked me about my home and my folks, and I told him. Then he said that I was a lucky boy to have a good home. There wasn't a place in Omaha fit to live, and not a place where a man could get any decent food. Then and there, a brilliant inspiration dawned upon me. I was aghast before its grandeur, and it took all my courage to propose it, but I did. My mother was the finest cook in the world. I knew that, though I'd never thought much about it. There marched before me a procession of her fragrant masterpieces, angel cake and pancakes, roast chicken with dressing, and steak smothered in onions. We had taken a big house when we came to Omaha, and several times Mother had said that if she got a chance, she'd like to take in a boarder or two. It would help so much financially. All in one breath, I asked this immaculate and handsome young juvenile if he'd like to come and live at our house. He came the next morning, moved in that afternoon, and, in the process, acquired a young slave to do his bidding. From then on, I lived in his dressing room. I sat and watched him make up. I brushed his clothes. I kept his dressing room and table clean. I ran his errands, heard him recite his parts, and I am sure would gladly have died for him. I have never met anyone since who seemed to me as wonderful as he did at that time. At last, I confided to him my own ambition, and told him of what little experience I had. When the company put on Tess of the D'Urbervilles, I was cast for Abraham, Tess's little brother. It was a great kid part, and I had the third act curtain all to myself. Mr. O'Connor worked with me at home, and he was mighty patient and so pleased when I showed improvement. Lloyd Ingram, now a noted motion picture director, was stage director of that company. I never will forget the first word of praise or real encouragement I ever got. It came from Mr. Ingram. There were two speeches very much alike in the second act. The last one was my cue, but I got mixed up one night and went on at the first one. It would have spoiled the whole act, and Mr. Ingram, out in front, nearly had apoplexy. I saw what I'd done, and somehow had just enough presence of mind not to back off, nor to stand there listening. But I strolled upstage, as though I wasn't paying any attention, and began to tinker with a wheelbarrow, like a kid will. I had my back to the others, and didn't turn around until my cue came. Mr. Ingram came back, gave me a whack on the shoulder that nearly disabled me, and bellowed, "Young man, you'll make your mark in this business." Frank Bacon, who became the theatrical idol of the country in Lightnin', was a member of that company. He was mighty kind to me and used to give me advice and help me. He wasn't much known at that time. I played 8 pieces there, including The Little Minister. When the season closed, Frank Bacon wanted me to go on the road with him in a vaudeville sketch he had written, somewhat along the lines of Lightnin'. But Mother put her foot down. Acting was all very well, but I needed my schooling, and she wouldn't allow me to travel where I wouldn't have a chance to stay in school. I had reached that awkward stage anyway, where I was too big for kids and too awkward and young for juveniles. So, for a time, my acting was suspended. But then I got on a hobby of makeup. I'd seen just enough watching Lloyd Ingram and Frank Bacon and Mr. O'Connor at the theater to realize what it was, and I spent all the money I could earn on grease paint and putty, and I used to scare my family pretty near to death with some of the rigs I got on. I went on to high school then. In all, I attended 5 different high schools, beginning in Omaha. We were still moving. And it was while I was in my second year at the East Denver High School that I had my first glimpse of love's young dream. Up to that time, girls hadn't entered my life. I was scared to death of them. I couldn't dance, and I didn't see any use for them anyway. But at the East Denver High School, I saw Hyacinth. That was her name, Hyacinth. Even now, I must congratulate myself upon my taste. She was a beauty. She had a lovely olive skin and dark blue eyes and the prettiest slender hands. I sat beside her in 3 classes, and I existed only for those delicious hours. I don't think I ever spoke to her, and I'm sure she didn't know I existed. I was long and lanky and still freckled, and I would have swooned if she'd smiled at me, I was so shy. But I worshipped her at a distance for many months. When I was 16 and my brother Gaylord was 21, my mother and father separated, and mother obtained a divorce. It was a question of incompatibility, and they both agreed to it as the best thing. While we boys were mighty sorry, it wasn't a tragedy to us. They had waited until we were grown, and had our lives ahead of us, and were ready to get out into the world. I never remember that they quarreled, and I loved and respected them both very much. And there was never any attempt on their part to separate me from either of them. I have always thought they did a very fine thing in keeping us happy and giving us a good home and a united family life until we were grown. Then I felt they had a right to decide for their own happiness. After their separation, I spent my time with either of them, just as seemed most convenient. About this time, I took a short flyer into another profession. I decided I wanted to be a prize fighter. I can't imagine now why this ambition was born in my manly bosom. I didn't like to fight. Even as a kid, though I don't believe I was a coward, I wasn't ever one to pick a fight, and I liked to use diplomacy when I could. But I did like athletics, and I particularly liked gymnasium work. I was always in the gym, doing work on the bars or the rings. So I decided on a ring career. But I didn't like to fight, and while I got a little thrill out of the crowds, my career as a pugilist was brief and not particularly brilliant. I only fought a few times, and then I decided that I had been right in the first place, and returned to my first desire, the stage. Right then came the next big break in my fortune. Father got $4,000 damages from a company for an accident that had injured him, and we decided to go traveling. Father had a real hankering to go to New York, but I wanted to go to California. My friend O'Connor was in San Diego, playing in stock, and also running a dramatic school, and I felt I could get back into my stage work through him. Besides, my brother Gaylord was headed westward on the vaudeville circuit, and I thought we might join forces. We debated a good while, because Dad held out for New York. Finally, we decided to flip a coin. Heads California, tails New York. It came heads, and we started west immediately. I was just 18, and I had barely heard of motion pictures. That was in 1911. I made my first appearance in a motion picture in San Diego about a year later, and I played an Indian. End of first installment.